page 400.
They are running some cultures, and it'll take at least 2 days for the cultures to be back. But that they are treating her for that because that's what they feel like that she has. So anyway, please remember her and lift her up before the Lord. She has asked for no visitors because she's in a lot of pain, and so she really would prefer that just her immediate family come in to see her. So please remember Sister Jennifer and lift her up before the Lord. I know I did call a few people. I didn't get around to everybody, but I knew we had church tonight and I would be able to announce it. So please remember her and lift her up before the Lord. The enemy is just working overtime, it seems like, in our church. But God's still the same, and God is the healer, and we're going to believe that she is going to be fine, that they will find that it's not that at all, that it's her fibromyalgia just kicking up, and a fever or whatever, but we're going to believe it's not that. So, also, Brother Kim called and said that Sister Donna is very, very sick, and Brother Sherman also, and so he stayed home to take care of both of them. They're both running a high fever and really sick with this, whatever it is that's going around. So anyway, remember them and lift them up before the Lord. And still remember Brother Pat and lift him up before the Lord. Someone else, Sister Monica.
Yeah, I remember my mom and my cousin Karen and my cousin Dina, they all went to Shanawha, Florida, and they made a safe trip back, so they just left, I think, Tuesday or Friday, Monday. But anyway, just pray that God give them safe travels. And, yeah.
Yeah.
And they burn, and I don't know what else to do. I just pray every night that God just takes care of me.
Your finger is worse? Oh, your other hand?
Both of my hands are broke out.
So maybe it wasn't that at all?
Yeah, it must have been something. If it was a wedding ring, then it was brass, and the wedding ring, and all just went to my sister, who knows. But God knows what it was.
Absolutely. God can clean it up, can you, Brother Shane?
Yes, mother. They ran out of money earlier. Yeah, a phone. She had a phone, because she was struggling. But I remember Brother Terry, we seen him the other day. He said, just keep praying for him, God's working on him.
Amen.
He said, he'll be back.
All right. Amen. Sister Caroline.
I keep praying for my children, my grandchildren, my great-grandchildren. Pray for me, I am very good. My eyes, I can't hardly see on my eyes.
Remember that. Sister Judy.
Remember my medical neighbor, Heather and Tommy Schoolcraft, and their little 4-year-old boy, Jonathan. They had to take him to Riley Hospital because he's been having seizures. And they can't predict that he's got epilepsy until he's 6 years old and he's only 4. So he has to keep going to the doctors and checking on him. But he keeps having these seizures and they have to get sick a lot. So just keep it in your prayers.
Amen. Brother Chuck.
Me on Summer's called me to do a funeral for Janice Flinner, Ronnie Flinner's wife. That's going to be sad to remember that happened.
Amen. Amen. To remember that. And isn't Hein Giselle having a breakfast or something this weekend? I thought I read that paper. Maybe I was mistaken. I don't know. I didn't just glance at it. I figured if there was, you would know. But anyway, remember that. And I did say tomorrow night from 6 o'clock till 6 o'clock Saturday evening, the church will be open for people to come in and pray. And it's not to come in and have a gap session. It's to come in and earnestly get a hold of God and to pray. And the church will be open from 6 to 6, 24 hours. And it is to come and meditate on the Lord and to pray. We've got loved ones that are out of the ark of safety. We've got loved ones that need a healing. We got loved ones that so many things going on in their life, deliverance and for some. So we just really need to get a hold of God. And we decided that this Friday would be the time that we were going to do it. So anyway, if you can't come and stay the whole 24 hours, you can only come and stay an hour or 2 hours or 6 hours or whatever you can stay, the doors will be open for you to be able to come in and to pray. Okay? Sister Paula.
Please remember all the kids. Remember the Jacobs, little Mom Billy and Darla and her babies. Sissy and her babies, Gina, Vanessa, and Fran, and all them.
Is Fran still in the hospital?
Not exactly sure. I haven't talked to Gina since the other days. Please remember me and John, and then remember me and my heart and my mind.
Amen. Someone else. Sister Shekana. Remember mommy, okay. Pray for your JJ. All right. And Sister Patty.
Could you remember my children, grandchildren, and all my loved ones? Remember Sister Edna? She got to where she just can't get around anymore. They've got home health coming in with her. Just be great.
Amen. Anyone else?
Georgianne.
Oh, Georgianne, I know, had her hand up probably the whole time, hadn't she?
No, I need you to call me. I'd like for the church to continue to remember Renee. She has breast cancer. Please remember her and remember the teacher that has the cancer in her femur. I'd like for the church to remember my mom and dad. They're going to Ohio tomorrow. Their church is. Their pastor's going to be preaching there. And there's going to be about 15 to 20 people going there. I'm using my mom and dad's van. There's going to be 9 in that van. They're going to be carpooling. So just pray that the Lord will bless that service. And And I'd like for the church to carry me and Brother Tim. We got some big decisions we got to be making here. I mean, they're big. And it's going to affect the whole family. It's going to affect a lot of things. Our jobs, it's going to affect. Like I said, a lot of the family and our jobs and our home situation and everything. But it's a decision that's got to be made. So we're just asking for God's will. To guide us in which way, what direction he wants us to take. So please remember that. And remember my children as a whole. Please take Natasha on her heart. She did get a job. Just pray that she gets her head out of the sand and does what's right for her babies. And Jonathan gets back to First Stacy and Shekinah. It's hard not saying you don't worry about your kids because you do. Remember our church as a whole. As Sister Daisy said, the enemy is attacking. He's not only attacking, you know, our immediate church family, but our families out of the church too. Please remember that. And remember all of our kids. It's out this summer, this fall break. There's a lot of them. I got a few of them on my list, and this little boy, he's been bullied, and we don't have a very good home life. We just have a lot of burden for all these kids that's out here, because, you know, if we can't reach them, Satan's going to.
Absolutely.
We just need to cover them, and remember Sean and Lisa and them, they're going to be leaving tomorrow to go on their honeymoon to Smoky Mountains, and they're going to take the kids, so. Remember them that they have a safe trip and they can just get away and relax their minds, maybe the joy situation.
Good, Tim.
The one that used to fill the seat, or for some reason another fell by the wayside.
Amen. Absolutely. Someone else. Janice.
Pray for our nation and our government. And that was one of my prayers, that we pray for those that are actually out of the church. And pray for, I pray for the school kids, and that the attack on their minds and their thinking of you know, destruction and suicide, that
you can
somehow reach him.
Amen. You can spirit.
Absolutely. Is it Brother Tony?
Yeah, he's bringing in me and Mary, first of all, and he go back to the school directly. And my sister Mary, I can't get hold of her. I'm really worried. She didn't see me. I'm really worried about
what happened to her. Remember Sister Ashley and the kids, they were here Tuesday night, so remember them and lift them up before the Lord.
Got any prayer requests?
No, Sister Redmond, right. I mean, she's been having some nightmares.
Who had them as a student?
I saw some requests by that lift of hands. Let's all pray together. Mighty Savior, as we come before this night, we're so thankful, Lord, that we know that we can look unto thee as the author and finisher of our faith. We know, Lord Jesus, by your stripes we are healed. We know each and every one of the names that's been called out this night. We know cancer is just a word, that name of Jesus is above every name in heaven and earth, in earth, Lord Jesus. And we just ask, Mighty Savior, that your will be done in each and every one of these request, Lord, we pray, hallelujah, to God that is able to meet each and every one of the needs. We just rebuke this thing that is going on around us, Lord Jesus. And hallelujah, this infections or whatever it is, Lord. And hallelujah, we just ask, Mighty Savior, that your will be done, Lord Jesus. We know, hallelujah, that you're a God that is able. We know, Lord, that those that's fallen by the wayside, we ask that you stir up that Holy Ghost that lies within them, Mighty Savior. Hallelujah, and draw them back by your Spirit, Lord. Man cannot come unless you draw them, Lord. And we just ask, hallelujah, as we attempt to pray and to worship you, Lord Jesus, that you let that Holy Ghost and that Spirit just flow in those mighty Savior's life that needs it. all of our loved ones that are out of the ark of safety. Hallelujah, just have your way, mighty Savior. Remember Sister Jennifer, as we lift her up before you, mighty Savior, knowing full well that you are the author and the finisher for the faithful and that you're a God that is able. Remember, each and every one in this sick this night, Lord. Remember Sister Don and Brother Sherman this night, Lord. As we lift him up, remember the peace of Israel, Lord Jesus. Mighty Savior, we know, Lord, that is your country. Hallelujah, that you are in control. Remember our government this night, Lord Jesus, as we lift our leaders up before you, Lord Jesus, according to your word. Hallelujah, just have your way, Lord, with each and every one, mighty Savior, all of your children this night, Lord. Keep your hand upon them, mighty Savior, as we give you the praise, the glory, and the honor, mighty Jesus. Just have your way, Lord. Truly, we're going to believe your report, not the report of the enemy, Lord Jesus, but your report, Lord. And by your report, Lord, we are healed. That we walk in victory, Lord, and I just ask, mighty Savior, right now, that you be with each and every one of these this night, Lord. Truly, we give you the praise, the glory, and the honor in Jesus' precious name. We ask it. Let the church say, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Brother Kevin, you have a song tonight?
Of course he does.
I know you have your song. Decisions, decisions. I meant decisions.
Daily bread. I think it was, I believe it was in today because I had to leave yesterday. So I forgot. Read the days. You know, the other night we, most everybody Tuesday night kind of touched on about the same subject. Even though I know that people, that the, you know, that the Lord does give people signs a lot of times, but I was thinking that there's so much scripture in the Bible that tells us to continue on. And he wants us to be prepared and not lose sight of what's going on in the world. But yet you can't come to a complete stop, and because you know he's got the whole world in his hands, and it's those that have who will go on to be with him. It just doesn't matter what's going on out there in the world. It's many times we think of Y2K and everybody went nuts. And the different things that's going on that everybody says, well, that's it, that's the end of the world. But you know what? They can all be signs, but still yet. The Bible tells me, from what I've read, that man, there's only one person who knows the time, and it's sure not us. It's the Lord himself. So, I guess I'll sing He Came to Me.
What's that, A?
That separated me from Christ my Lord. It was so vast, the crossing I could never ford. From where I That's why.
I've got to make Jesus my home. I've got to make heaven my home.
I'm storing up treasures in heaven, Sister Daisy. That's where I'm storing up my treasures at. I'm not looking in the world. I'm not worried about Ebola or whatever that thing is, or ISIS or whatever it is. I'm not worried about that, because you know what? My Bible says that He didn't give me a spirit of fear.
Amen.
And I'm not going to be fearful. When they talk about it, I said, well, if it comes and hits me, it's just that much quicker for me to get home. You know? And you know what? I'm ready. I'm ready to go, Sister Daisy. But I got some loved ones out here that isn't. And it's really great my spirit. Because you know what? I was talking to Sister Daisy. I went to her house the other day. Poor people. I just laid all out for them. Just cried. And you know, if you can't go to your pastor and your pastor's wife, who can you go to, really? I mean, honestly, besides Jesus. But we need to consider our brothers and our sisters, because nobody knows what another one goes through. Sister Daisy, I know you're having a hard time with Brother Pat. I know that, because I was a caretaker myself. I know what it is to take care of somebody 24 hours a day. Yeah, we laugh and joke about it, but it is tiresome. I know that. And I want you to know, I pray for you constantly. I pray for our pastor constantly. Because you know what? Like I said, the devil is trying to wear out the saints. He's trying to get us so where we are so down and depressed, where there's days that I don't even know when I can lift my head up. And I just pray, Lord, please put me on somebody's heart. Please just let somebody pray for me. And I'll get on my Facebook, and one day everybody says it's so bad about it, and somebody will be on there, Sister Georgette, I had you on my heart today. Or they'll put a scripture on there, Sister Wendy. And I'll say, boy, did I need that one today. Now, God says that He is always an eye seeing eye, and He's mindful of every situation we go through.
Yes, He is.
Every situation. It don't matter. You might not know what I'm going to, but my God does. And I thank Him and praise Him, and I'm going to shut up, and I want to sing you a song. It's called Another Valley. Because there's a lot of these trials, like today, if they call me about Sister Jennifer, I don't understand this trial for her. I don't understand how bad things can happen to good people. The Bible says this: our thoughts are not His thoughts. Our ways are not His ways. He's got a plan, and you better believe she's in His will. So just leave her in His hands and watch the miracle. Now I'm telling you, it's going to be a miracle come out of this. A miracle is going to come out of this. And there's going to be souls. Because I'm telling you, there's going to be souls in this church. Because how do I know? Because I've been birthing. I don't know about anybody else, but I've been birthing. I've been traveling. I'm seeing it spiritually, Sister Daisy. There's going to be some growth in this church. That's why Satan is fighting so much, because of the growth. He don't want to see growth. But you know what? Like I said at the beginning, He's a liar and a father of all liars. I don't understand this trial.
praise him anyway. I don't care how short of breath I am. Because God's good. I'm gonna try to sing the kids. It's a little high right now, but I'm gonna try. Just a closer walk.
Oh,
right.
And sometimes, you know, the prayers that God puts on your heart to pray. You know, just a few weeks ago, I went out to go to the hospital and see my daughter. She tried to commit suicide.
Oh, my.
And I'll tell you what, she couldn't understand. She put a belt over her door, and when she kicked the stool out, a heavy belt broke. And she couldn't understand. I said, I do right. Every night, I said, I lay there and I pray myself to sleep. And I said, you're always on my mind. My three kids, I said, you know, your mom's gone, but I said, it's still my responsibility. But you know, I thought, you know, how awful it is when somebody has to go down to a casket and one of their kids. And some people, the majority of the people who don't know the Lord, they just stand there and wring their hands and they cry and they don't know what to do. But the time to do it is before it happens.
Absolutely.
Get a hold of God. And let him know. I mean, I was out at the nursing home for about 4 hours today. Bill Watkins is out there now. And Patty Folks is my cousin. She doesn't have, you know, she's got two brothers left. But only one of them comes out to see her every once in a while. And you know, it's a lonely place when you're in a nursing home and there's nobody there to come to see you. Your brother Pat didn't have to worry about that. He had more company than he needed most of the time. But you know, that's a blessing. I thought out there today, as out there visiting different places, and look at some of the people laying there asleep, you know, that's all they have to do. And that most of them don't sleep because they're tired. And those who are depressed, they don't know what to do. But you know, when you got some free time, walk down to a nursing home and see if you can help some of them. God, you know, God saved your soul. You know, he didn't just tell you to sit down and take it easy. He told you to go out there and, you know, and do what he called you to do. But you know, the Lord starts out with a lot of different people, you know, and Saul of Tarsus was a man who, you know, he lost his reason for living. He lay on the ground, he was blind, and he thought that, you know, when he used to put the church down, hurting the church, he thought he was doing God's work. But then he found out that God had a different work for him. And the best time in your life is when you're doing something for God.
Amen.
You know, I used to be a drunk. My stepfather, Ned, that just passed away, he said, one thing he said he knew about me, he said, I used to be an old Navy man. He said, you had such a foul mouth on you, he said, you even embarrassed me. But God has a way of changing you. I attended Bart and Moose, and they couldn't understand why, when I got saved, that I gave that life up. I said, have you ever tried to tell Jesus, somebody about Jesus over a bottle of beer? So somebody can look at your life and the life that you used to live and they know, and that they notice the changes. But you know, Saul was a man that he wanted to be an important person when he started out. And he was. But he became a more important person when he became God's person. God was telling him to get up and stand up and to have a purpose in life. Everybody's got a purpose in life. It's just according to what you take. If you take that purpose in life and you have to do something for it. I was talking to my daughter. She didn't think she had a purpose in life. And I said, you've got four kids that need you.
Right.
Nobody's going to take care of their kids like you do. She knew that I would take them in if something happened to her. She went, I just had a stroke not too long ago. And sometimes when you start getting old, you start feeling your age. And sometimes, you know, try to take care of some of the kids. Most of my kids are, you know, are out on her own. Dustin comes over and he's got three kids and they're little. And sometimes, you know, little Owen comes over and he wants to get on Papa's lap and he wants to start telling me different stuff and I can't understand the word he's saying. As Dustin told me the other day, he's got his words mixed. He was trying to say different words and it was coming out and it was embarrassing to Dustin. He was trying to say sucker. And Dustin said now, he said, Dad, we don't let him say sucker, we call it lollipops. He gets his words mixed up. But you know, I was thinking, you know, when Dustin used to be little. I've taken three of my daughters to South Dakota. And I didn't have any trouble with Katie. I didn't have any trouble with Savannah. But when I took Mackenzie, got to cry. I looked over and she started crying. We hadn't even crossed the state line yet. And she started crying. I said, what's wrong? She said, I miss my mommy. I had to drive 700 miles from Martinsville up into Iowa. And I got up there, and the next morning we got up and went over to the South Dakota to St. Joseph Indian School. We unloaded those clothes and I come back and I went back to bed. And I got up the next morning and drove about 700 miles back home. And she cried all the way. And I said, it's going to be all right. We'll be home before long. But I miss Mommy. But you know, when I got home, I told my daughter, I said, about how she cried there. She said, Dad, I can tell you what the problem was. She said, my biblical cord just wasn't long enough. But you know, sometimes the things that we do with our kids and our families, sometimes you see that other kids, you know, people having something. You can look back on your life and you can laugh now. But it wasn't funny at the time it happened to you. But you know, God is trying to tell us to stand up on our feet and go out and spread the gospel around. And sometimes even if it's just going to a nursing home to visit somebody. And I go down to St. Charles and I'll tell you what, St. Charles, Virginia. I've got a lot of friends down there now. I can walk up the street up from the mission and I can talk to Kenny's family down there. And there's a lot of them. But you know, they want you to know one thing. They might be poor, but they're proud. And I mean, you take something that, you know, you can never go wrong trying to help somebody. Even if it's just going to a nursing home to tell somebody, you know, if you walk down the hallway and you see somebody that you know, stop letting them know what you care about. We went out to a nursing home down in Spencer. And one man I stopped in and talked to him and don't even remember what his name is. But he was a truck driver. He takes me on a lot of trips. I stand there sometime, you know, it gets kind of boring. I've heard the story more than once. But he keeps telling me, you know, and how much that he misses it. And you're gonna be looked out next to you if you don't allow him to use you. You know, they talk about people in the military stuff, they're getting commissions to go do something. Each and every one of us is on commission from God. I was 36 years old before I ever got saved. And when I got saved, it impressed me so much that God wanted me. And when I got up out of order, I wanted to be what God wanted me to be. Sometimes when you don't know what God wants, pray and ask Him. And read your Bible. You know, this Bible was written for everybody. And it's an instruction book.
Right, it is.
And you find that instruction book and you find where God wants you to go. The things He wants you to say. And there's been a lot of people in the Bible saying, can you do it, Lord? He said, yes, you can. But Jesus said, you know,
get that spirit inside of you and get it up. Sometimes what our main problem is we let the inner man get down. And we don't try to lift it up. And the things that God's wanted you to do for a long time, sometimes you will help somebody and you think that, well, God, you asked me to do this a long time ago. And I like this. I know this person. I didn't know they were hurting. Well, you know, if you've done what God wants you to do to start with, go out and let God use you. But you know, God called Paul, and he called Saul. But you know, Paul was under confession. He went out and preached the gospel. Sometimes, you know, I've seen people preach, and you could feel the anointing that God had put on them. And where would they be if they hadn't gone out and done what God wanted them to do? You know, there's no doubt in my mind. October 23rd, 1977, I hadn't answered God's call. God wouldn't answer my prayer, you know, to watch over my daughter. God is a God that cares about you. He's still on the throne. He's still answering prayer.
Amen.
And when you think that, you know, God's not going to answer your prayer, sometimes the reason he didn't answer your prayer, you haven't asked him. God, you know, sometimes we think God's a mind reader. And he can read your mind. But God wants you to, when you read this Bible and you see in this Bible what God has done something for somebody, he'll do the same thing for you. He's done it over and over again. But you know what? God is still there. And Saul Tarsus was a man who lost every reason for being. He thought, you know, when God spoke to him, you know, that God didn't want to do anything for him. God was saying to him, get up and stand up and stay up to the purpose that I've called you to your life. Sometimes, you know, there's been people that have been in the ministry so long and they still haven't done anything. They haven't gone out with the thing that God called them to do. And God has you to read your Bible for one reason. There's different things in there that he wants you to know. And he's trying to tell you one thing. If I've done it for somebody else, I'll do it for you. I'll send you out to the same places that I've sent that. But one thing you have to be willing to go. But you know, there's an anointing on each and everyone's life. You know, for your hands or who you are. And my kids were raised in church. Mom took us to church. But Mom is the one that got me started. You know, the best place for God to speak to your heart is an altar of prayer. Sometimes I've been in church and God they give an altar call, and I remember one time in the youth service. I think I went to the altar because everybody, all the other teams went. But if God gets you to the altar, he can talk to you. And you know, God has dealt me down through the years at different things he's had me go do. I've been out to South Dakota and to different places. We went down, we've been down to Chamberlain, South Dakota three times out there. And sometimes when you take a grandchild out there or somebody, you know, you're planting a seed. Katie said one time we just pulled back on I-9 and was heading back. She said, that's all I've been on my first missionary trip. I said, don't make it your last. But sometimes, you know, as kids, we say something to please somebody. But God takes that, he puts it in your heart, he plants a seed. And one of these days, you know, Katie will be out there and she'll go back out there, that same Indian reservation, the school that I go to, where she's invited to go, and she'll say, well, my papa took me out there a long time ago. But sometimes when you plant a seed, sometimes and some people it takes longer to grow than it does in others. You know, sometimes we get into scrapes and stuff in our life and we don't know what's doing. And sometimes when you find out, it's something that you didn't do. God's put it on your heart a long time to go do something. Or maybe it took years before you let somebody else talk you into going and found out that God had already called you to go there to start with. You know, Jeff Sisko is out from Martin, South Dakota. Has been a missionary for out there for over 30-some years. And that's what got me started out there. I started taking, when I see Jeff and I kept venturing out into different missionaries out there. God, if you'll let God use you, find out what He wants you to do. The Bible says study to show yourself approved. If you study to show yourself approved, God's going to use you. And it may, something that may not seem big to you could be big to somebody else. They told me down at the first load of clothes I took down this right before school started. They said there'd probably been a lot of kids down that wouldn't have school clothes if we hadn't brought those clothes down. You know, it wasn't a big thing to us. But sometimes when you help somebody, the thing that God's trying to do, he gets the job done through you. Paul said one thing, he said, I believe God. The fact that God has spoken and caused Paul to put his faith in God's word. He believed it in his heart. He did not doubt that he spoke the word. He said, I believe God. You know, that's what we have to do. We have to believe when God calls you to do something. It's not, you know, that wasn't just some idle thought that God put in your head. You know, I probably been going to Gateway probably close to 20 years now. You know, I've learned a lot from my pastor. And sometimes when you might think that you know everything. But you know, I go to Brother Pat, and I might have expected a big answer, you know, for something. It was just something simple. He spoke to me. And more or less telling you, let God do the teaching. But you know, as you read your Bible and study it, you can put yourself in it. God's no respecter of a person. Put yourself in that person's place and some of the things that's went on in the Bible. Those things could happen to you.
Like you. Yeah.
And you know, God has a promise for each and every one of us. He wants us to go out and to preach the gospel. And how precious it is, you know, when you invite somebody. I taught a sixth grade boys Sunday school class for 18 years. And I walked into the body shop a while back behind the old jail. Car, and Matt Richardson said, Chuck, I was in your Sunday school class. You know, it's a wonderful thing that you made an impression that you taught somebody. But God didn't put you in to make you an important person. He put you in to win souls. The most precious thing you could ever do is win somebody to Christ.
Amen.
You know, if you come up on a wreck and there's nobody there to stop, and the main things you can do is somebody's hurt bad in that car, get in that car with him and start telling them about Jesus. Ask them a question, do you know Jesus Christ is your Lord and your Savior? If he does, you know, lead him. God will use you if you're allowed to. But you know, as we ran, you know, as we rise up through our Christian walk with God, let it be beneficial to the ministry. I didn't put you out here to make you an important person. Jesus Christ is the most important person in anybody's life. And the most important thing is to put him into somebody's life that doesn't know him. How wonderful it is, you know, to stop in an accident. And I stopped at a lot of them when I was driving a truck. I was out there for 30 years. Stop and, you know, go in and pray with somebody. I've led some of them to the Lord that were dying. But you know, there was a state cop, and he said, you know, when I got saved when I was as a teenager, and he said, as I grew older, he said, being a state cop, he said, I thought I was an important person, and I drifted away from God. One night, he said, they called me out to a wreck, and I was out there. It was a young boy laying out in the road. And he said, I went over and I picked him up in my arms and was talking to him. And he said, the boy said, I'm not saved. He said, I don't want to die and go to hell. He said, you know, that night, God, I led that boy to the Lord, but he said, God also led me back to him. How important it was, you know, to keep in your mind that there's somebody more important out there than you are. And you just think one of these days when you get to, I had a dream the other night. I laid there and God kept telling me all the people that I had met down through my Christian walk. And you see their faces. Mabel Lawson was one of them. Her son used to manage the old parties over there. She was such a Christian walk for me. Every time, you know, she always had the answer. I'd go to her to pray about something. And you see, back when she prayed about it, it happened. But God can use you, or we can lose him. If we lose him, you know, we will all stay with him. God is the most important thing. He's the most beautiful thing in this world that we can ever have. God is there, and he wants you to know how many times he's called you. And how many times he called me before I got saved, because I didn't answer him. I've been in an accident and stuff that never got a stretch out. Just told him to be here before. But you know, I found out after I got saved, I'm a coward. But these things start getting. I used to drive a truck out there. And you ever get a semi sliding sideways in the dark, Kenny? It's the longest ride you'll ever take. But I tell you what, I'm a coward. I start calling on Jesus, and then that thing starts sliding. I call on him, and I tell you what, you're lucky enough. I did that up on one mission one night. Before I lost it, I hollered Jesus. And then he started to go over and make me. Yeah, it was about 4 or 5 or 50 foot in make me get ready to slide over. When I hollered Jesus, that guy took the front of that semi and just took it on up. I was still on the disc, but I'll tell you what, I didn't go over anything. And when you're in trouble, call the ones can help you.
Amen.
They can tell you about all these phony gods and all the things that they can do. But without Jesus, I'll tell you what, there's nobody can answer. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Look at your life and let God use you. My prayer is, Lord, use me and don't lose me. It's so easy to get involved in the things of the world. And I've had people call me up and want to read my heart horoscope. I called up and she wanted to explain to me. I said, I don't need to hear it. I said, I got a God that's in charge.
Amen.
And I said, if there's any horoscope reading, I said, I want him to do it. She said, but we do a lot of good things. I said, well, he does too. But I want to serve a God that's still on the throne and still answers prayer. And I've never read anything that somebody could do something through a horoscope. There's a lot of people who can do a lot of preventing, but it's Jesus Christ that makes it happen. Thank you.
Boy, but it takes time to grow and grow and, you know, grow in grace and knowledge and to get to grow strong in the Lord. No, through the years of, I don't know how long it took him to, through the years of tending this father's sheep, he killed the bear and the lion in the process. And then he was called to take the food to the army. But Chuck thought about that. He goes, not that, but they were, when they sing, what's his name? The big tall dude.
Goliath.
They feared. And they were scared. They ran off. But the big tall dude, yeah. But they said, I killed the bear and the lion. He got the lion by the beard. What does that mean? He had that lion face to face, didn't he? And he killed the lion. So he knew that it, you know, that he had in God. And that's what I'm saying, it takes time to grow and get the strength in God and the reassurance that, you know, God will not send us where he won't equip us. And just, you know, it takes time to grow in grace and knowledge of the Lord and to be strong and that's, I don't know, I just wanted to put that out for somebody, you know, that he won't ever send us where he won't equip us. And I love him, you know.
Teach others also. So I went right along with what you were saying. Though therefore in your hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ, no man that warreth entangled himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. And if a man also strive for masteries, yet he be of not crowned, except he strive lawfully. The husbandman that laboreth must be first partakers of the fruits. Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ, the seed of David, is raised from the dead according to my gospel. Therefore, therein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. Therefore I endure all things for the elect's sake, that they may also obtain the salvation which in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. Amen. That's what we were taught, what Sister Georgia was talking about. We all, no matter who it is, every one of us is going to suffer to a certain extent. But he's already made a way of escape for every one of us. He's already made a way, no matter what it is we're going through. We just have to find that way sometimes. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. He cannot not deny himself of these things, put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord that they strive not about words to no profit, but to the subversing of the heart of the hearers, surely to show thyself, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So we have to rightly divide the word of truth. We have to study, like when we studied, we've been talking about, George Ann was talking about that too, studying the word of God. We have to study the word of God to show approved. That's what God tells us we have to do. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth.
Right.
But shun the very appearance. I'm sorry. I'm just didn't say right, but shun profane and vain babbling, for they will increase unto more ungodliness. If we allow the enemy to take over, he will grow and grow and grow, and it will just become bigger, is what that is saying. But anyway, that was the thoughts that was on my heart tonight. Like I said, I'm not going to go into a lot of it, but we know that God has called us to do work, and God has called each and every one of us, no matter who it is. He's called us all to do a work in Him. And in Matthew, the 28th chapter, verse 18, the last verse 18, it says, "And Jesus came and spoke unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost." What's that name? That name is Jesus Christ. "Teach them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen." And truly, He is with us at all times. And I just praise Him and I thank Him. And yes, Brother Chuck, there's so many of us that need to do more all the time. That's the reason why we decided to have this 24 hours of prayer. The church will be open, like I said, from 6 o'clock tomorrow evening till 6 o'clock Saturday evening. If you can't come and stay the whole time, that's fine. But just come and stay a part of that time and pray. Get a hold of God. With every one of us, I don't care who it is, every one of us have got people in our family that is lost and not serving God. At one time, a lot of them have known God and they've fallen by the wayside.
Yeah.
And we've got a lot of people that are sick that need to, and I mean, we know that by His stripes we are healed, and He took our afflictions upon Himself that we might be able to walk in victory. And He is the healer. Says, "Healing is the children's bread." Well, if I ask you for bread, you're not going to give me a stone. But so God's word is faithful and is true. And so we know that there's a lot of people that is sick. And we know that God is the healer of those that are sick and afflicted. So we need to have earnest prayer. George Ann was talking about travailing. If you've never had a travailing spirit, it's time you got busy with God. And I'm not talking about just coming and saying a few little things and just about your family, but there's other families that are in need tonight. You know, there's a lot of people that are in need. There's people that are addicted and to drugs. There's alcoholics. There's, there's just so many different things that people are. Pornography and so on and so forth. There's a lot of things in this world that the devil has slid over of the children of God, and God never intend for anybody to go to hell. But it says hell is increasing itself every day.
Right.
It's enlarging itself every day, it said, because the enemy has deceived the people. But I'm telling you, it's time. God is soon to come back, and I really believe that from my heart, that God is soon to come back after people who have made themselves ready. I can't make you ready.
No.
Nobody else can. You're the only person that can make yourself ready. And I tell you, if you're not ready when it comes, I would hate to be left behind. It will be a terrible, terrible day if you're left behind. He's going to come as a thief in the night and take His church, His people out of here. And if you're left behind, now I'm not saying there won't be some that won't endure, but it's going to be a terrible, terrible time. Time worse than we've ever, ever seen. A lot worse than what we've gone through now if you're left behind.
Grace will be gone.
So we want to go in the rapture. We don't want to wait for that second coming. Amen. I believe that the first coming, we're not going to know when He comes. But the second, the whole wide world will see Him. Because
they'll know it.
They'll know it. Because we're coming back. We are coming back with Him. We are coming back with Him. Hallelujah.
So,
that's right. Absolutely. We're coming back with Him. Hallelujah. And So if you're left behind, I'm telling you, it's going to be a sorry, sorry state. So we have to be prepared. And he is coming soon. You know, if it's another 20 years, it's soon. The day is 1,000 years. 1,000 years is the day. So we don't know. It could be in the next hour. It could be next week. We do not know when it's going to be. But we know he is coming. And he's coming soon. Amen. Hallelujah. All hearts free. God is good. You'll stand. We'll be dismissed. Brother Tony, watch.